جميعا ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي علا في توحده ودنا في تفرده وجل في سلطانه وعظم في أركانه فطر الخلائق بقدرته ونشر الرياح برحمته ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد طب القلوب ودوائها ونور أبصارها وعلى أهل بيته الذين ذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا صلى على محمد وعلى محمد بهم نتولى ومن أعدائهم نتبرأ إلى يوم القيامة عباد الله أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل يقول الرسول الأكرم صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم حسين مني وأنا من الحسين أحب الله من أحب حسينا وأبغض الله من أبغض حسينا حسين سبت من الأصباط صدق الرسول الكريم. Once again we thank Almighty Allah تبارك وتعالى for gracing us with this wonderful moment to observe our weekly Eid, which is Juma. I first and foremost admonish myself and each and every one of us, mu'mineen and mu'minat, lovers and followers of Ahlul Bayt, to be conscious of the teachings of Almighty Allah, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Allahu Azza wa Jal, on numerous occasions in the Holy Quran, remind us of the importance of consciousness. The term used, as we all know, is taqwa. Let us try as much as we can to improve the levels of our consciousness in relations to the teachings of our beloved merciful Creator. The tradition I've just quoted is a known tradition to all of us, mu'mineen and mu'minat. This tradition no doubt highlights on the profound estate occupied by Aba Abdullah in the lands of our beloved prophets. The Holy Prophet says, Husaynun minni wa ana min al-Husayn. Husayn is indeed from me and I am from Husayn. Last week in our first sermon, we departed from same tradition and we looked at ways and means on how Aba Abdullah al-Husayn approached the entire event of Karbala. And it's of great importance, mu'mineen and mu'minat, as we go through these morning sessions, to try to extract practical lessons from the event of Karbala. Because the aim is to ensure that those practical lessons manifest in the lives of each and every one of us. Because at the end of the day, Aba Abdullah went out for one thing, which will highlight more in our sermon of today. He went out for nothing but to reform the ummah of his grandfather. So make sure, let us all try, including the speaker, each and every day of this morning season or sessions, try to take at least one lesson from Karbala. Karbala is an institution. Karbala is a university. So make sure we take something out of it. What I would like to briefly discuss in our first sermon of today, again departing from this beautiful tradition that Hussein is from me and I am from Hussein, is to look at the main similarities between the missions of the Holy Prophet Abba Abdullah and that of our beloved 12th Imam. Remember very well, last week in our sermon, we mentioned that beautiful tradition from our beloved 5th Imam. Inna min itmam al-ibadah lika'ul hujjah. The perfection of our servitude to Allah is dependent on the meeting of hujjah. Not necessarily meeting the hujjah physically. Of course, that is possible, but not easy. But whatever we do in this time of major occultation, we should try and endeavor to connect it with the preparation of the coming of Abba Salih al-Mahdi. Because he is the Imam of your time. 72 knew their Imam. They recognized their Imam. And they submitted wholeheartedly to the calling of their Imam. Your Imam, my Imam, is Abba Salih al-Mahdi. Do you recognize him? Do you know him? What are we doing to prepare for his reappearance? So let us look at three main similarities between these three missions. Of course, the mission of all prophets of Allah and messengers of Allah are same. But I just want to demonstrate looking at these three missions. The first similarity, kindly pay attention, brothers and sisters. Looking at these three missions or movements is the reality of these missions. These missions have same reality, haqiqa. They said, لِكُلِّ شَيْنَ haqiqa وَرَقِيقَ. Everything that you see, including insan, is made up of reality and substance. Yeah? So sometimes I may say your reality is that you're living in this world 50 years, 20 years. But what is important is the substance. This 50 years given to you by Allah, what have you achieved out of it? What have you achieved out of 50 years? You've been given 70 years, alive and kicking. What have you achieved? That's very, very important. You know, one tradition also, ad-du'a mukhul ibadah, meaning du'a raqiqatul ibadah. Du'a, if you go direct translation, is the skull of the worship. Meaning what? Du'a is the substance of worship. You can worship salah, salah, salah. Without du'a, there is no beatification. So, the mission of the Holy Prophet and that of Abba Abdullah and Abba Salih al-Mahdi are of the same reality. What's the reality of this mission? The reality of these missions is simple as this, that all these three missions, they are real missions and not emotional missions. Movements are of two kinds. We have a thawratun fi'li and we have a thawratun infi'ali. We have a real movement and we have emotional movement. Here, not to say emotions are not, emotions are unbelievable. Without emotion, nobody will worship God. So don't look at emotion here on a face value. Emotions are crucial. I and you believe and understand that Namaz Shab is excellent, but how many of us are waking up for Namaz Shab? You know why? We are intellectually connected with Namaz Shab, but emotionally we are not connected. You will start doing something when you are emotionally connected with it. This world is too dry. Why? Because people are more connected intellectually. You need that emotional part of it. So if you tell me coming to Abba Abdullah, only intellectual side, doesn't work out. I need to build the emotion part to make me feel good. So the reality of these missions is that they are real missions. They are not emotional missions. What's the difference between the two? You know, emotional missions or movement happen anyhow, haphazardly. But real movements do happen after proper scrutiny and study. In other words, Abu Abdullah did not just jump to Karbala. It's a real mission. It's a real movement. The movement is properly studied. The movement is informed by Allah. And the movement is predicted by the Holy Prophet. So Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam did not just embark on that journey. And I'll give you two traces or two examples to demonstrate to all of us that indeed this movement is a real movement. It's not an emotional movement. First example, Imam al-Hussein did not force anyone. In emotional movement, people are forced. And leaders will sit behind, fold their arms. Baba Imam Hussein was in the forefront of this movement. His son went first. Not only his children, 6 month child of Abu Abdullah. So that's why on the eve of Ashur, he extinguished or switched off the candle, whatever light they had. And he said to all, I am the target, you are not. Go. Go. And there is no blame in you. This is not just for the sake of saying. It's to tell us that this movement is a real movement. Think about it. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa alim. It's a real movement. That's one example. Second example, I would like us, when we have time, reflect on this example. Maybe you can expound on it. I don't think Imam Hussein went out only because he did not want to pay allegiance to Yazid. No. Yes, he did not pay allegiance, and he will never do that, with or without the movement. Imam, we didn't pay allegiance to Yazid, with or without the movement of Karbala. So Imam alayhi salam did not go to Karbala because, na'udhu billah, escaping from stretching his hand to Yazid. No. And Imam did not go to Karbala because of the letters of the people of Kufa. Yes, he sent his safir, go. Find out, scrutinize, feasibility study is crucial. But he didn't go because of that letter or those letters. Why did he go? Because the ummah was corrupt. That's why he went. So with or without letter, they were corrupt. Isn't it Muallim? They were corrupt. With or without Yazid pressurizing Abu Abdullah to pay allegiance, they were corrupt already. And hence, in that famous line to Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya, he made it very clear, isn't it? Innama kharajtu li talab al-islah fi ummati jaddi. I am out seeking to reform the ummah, the nation of my grandfather. Thus, a typical example of real movement or real revolution. Mu'minin, look at Abu Abdullah. He tried negotiating with these people not to share this blood and the blood of his companions. Up to the seventh day of Muharram. Up to the seventh day of Muharram. So this is a real movement. Imam Hussein didn't want any blood to be shed. He wanted them to change. He wanted them to reform. But Umar refused. He said, I'm promised big wealth. I'm promised that. Eventually, Abu Abdullah said, Zabahaka Allahu fi firashik. May Allah slaughter you on your bird. And you know, 5 years after Karbala, what happened to Umar ibn Sa'd and Shimr, you know. So that's number one similarity. The same thing Abbas Khalil al-Mahdi. His movement is real movement. It's not emotional movement, reacting to something. No. So that's why I and you need to work hard maybe we can be part of his companions. Even if we die, Allah can bring us back to serve alongside Abu Salih al-Mahdi. There is nothing more valuable to us in this day and age than to lay the grounds for the reappearance of the 12 Imam. Because the movement is real. It's about global justice. So that's number one. Second similarity, very simple one. The aim of these three movements is only one aim. And it's the aim of all the prophets of Allah. Quran 57, you check. Beautifully Allah mentioned. لَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُولَنَا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأَنزَلْنَا مَعَهُمُ الْقِتَابَ وَالْمِيزَانَ لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ. Al-Qiyam bil-Qist, to stand for justice, is the main hadaf, the main aim of all these three movements, and the movement of all prophets and messengers of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. The holy prophet of Islam came to establish divine justice on earth. Aba Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam went out to establish divine justice. Imam Sahib al-Amr, when he comes, he will come to establish liyamla al-arda qistan wa adla, isn't it? Ba'da ma muli'at zulman wa jawra. So it's the same aim, mu'minin and mu'minat. Justice, justice, justice. But as they say, justice begins with you. It begins in your house. It begins at your workplace. If you want to be with Imam al-Hussein, you want to be with Abu Salih al-Mahdi, you have to start implementing justice in your lives. Last similarity is Qaeda. They are companions. They have solid companions, solid supporters, unshakable supporters. Not double standard. Unshakable. Look at sincere and true companions of the Holy Prophet. Allah discusses them in the Holy Quran on numerous occasions. Ruhama'u bainahum, for example. They were there. People like Ammar ibn Yasir. People like Miqdad, for instance. People like Salman al-Farisi Muhammadi. And great companion like Amir al-Mu'mini. These are companions of the Holy Prophet. And it was only through these companions the Holy Prophet managed to establish Islam. Now look at the companions of Aba Abdullah. Aba Abdullah would say, I've never seen a companion like my, which is true. Because companions of the Prophet, when they're going for Badr, they were going for Uhud, for example, they knew they would go back home. There was a greater chance they would go back home. Companions of Amir al-Mu'minin could be Kumail ibn Ziyad al-Nakhai, could be Rushayd al-Hijri, could be Umar ibn Hamak al-Khuza'i. You name them. They knew, going to Siffin, going to Nahrawan, going to Jamal, we are going to come back home. The only companions who knew we will not go back home were the companions of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. So the Qawaid are very, very important. Had unbelievable companions who were willing to say, if we are chopped off and given life, and chopped off and given life 1,000 times, we will be proud to give it to the son of Fatima al-Zahra. So Imam al-Zaman also need sincere ones. It's not a joke. That's my Imam, that's your Imam. Are you waiting for him or he's waiting for you? You need to ask yourself that question. Who is waiting for who? Because you know, the Holy Prophet used to say, Allahumma lakini ikhwani. Ya Allah, inspire me with my brothers. So his companions used to ask him, who are your brothers? Are we not your brothers? You know what he said? He said, you are my companions. My brothers will be the people of the last time. They will not see me, but they will believe in me more than you. And they will help support and establish divine justice on earth. Allahu Akbar. That's very important. You may be one of them. Wallah. Stop giving excuses. No, we are living in this part of the world. Somebody living in Qom, somebody living in Najaf. Yes, those living in Qom and Najaf, they are exposed to spiritual nourishment. I agree 100%. But they also have their unique challenges. You have to try, mu'minin and mu'minat, including myself, to prepare for the reappearance of this great Imam. Because the companions of Imam are still in making. I leave you with this. You know, some of our great scholars hold this view, which I think is a solid view, that some of the true sincere companions of the 12th Imam are not yet Muslims, let alone being Shias. Think about it. So you can't, okay, we come here, we pray, we do everything. You never know. You never know. Typical example in Karbala. Wahab, you all know Wahab, you know. Wahab Kalbi. Wahab was a Christian. A Christian family, just put it that way. His mom, when she conceived Wahab, sickness upon sickness, like she was not going to make it. This is very important about our imams and wilaya. So someone spoke to the lady. There is a man in Kufa. Why don't you go to him for prayers? He will pray for you. And I believe in his prayers. That person was telling the lady, the mother of Wahab. So she went to Kufa to Amir al-Mu'mineen. Imam did not ask her, where are you from? She came for dua. Imam made dua for the survival of her son. And she went back, alhamdulillah, she got cured, and Wahab was born. Since then, she made intention. I need to see this man to thank him for what he's done to us. But she couldn't find Amir al-Mu'mineen anymore. Now, Aba Abdullah, if you have time, especially before Arba'in, read the event of Karbala thoroughly. You see, Aba Abdullah stopped in so many small towns and cities. Each town is a big lesson. You go islam.org and other books, you find they beautifully explain this. So he got to this small town. And Wahab saw Imam al-Hussein with children and women, because he realized most of the companions joined Aba Abdullah on the way, on the 10th day of Marwan. One narration I was reading says, 30 of those companions joined Aba Abdullah either on the 10th day of Muharram or days before the day of Muharram. Some cross from the enemies. So this Wahab saw Imam al-Hussein. He asked him, oh man, where are you going? He said, no, there is a leadership in Sham who is allowing injustice. So I'm going to administer justice. So his mom saw him. And she called him, Wahab, come, who are you talking to? He said, no, it's this man with children and women saying that he's going to ensure justice. So the mom asked him, what is the name of this man? So Wahab said, no, he said his name is Hussein, the son of Ali, the son of Abi Talib. Oh. Remember the narration says, Wahab just got him married 17 days. So what we call a honeymoon, it was not even done. 17 days. And he met Aba Abdullah. So the mother said, what is the name? Hussein, the son of Ali. I've been looking for the father of this man to thank him. If it wasn't of his prayers, I and you were not going to be alive. So they approached Aba Abdullah. But before approaching, Wahab looked at his mom and asked her, what do you want from me, mom? Said, I want one thing, join this man. Christians, not yet Muslims. How many prayed more than them in Medina, in Makkah, in Yemen, in other places? But they were willing to destroy and kill Abu Abdullah. So while his mom, now wife, just got him married, she also joined. The three of them joined Abu Abdullah, who was the first woman martyr in Karbala, the wife of Wahab. The wife of Wahab. She was the first. When Wahab was going, narration says, she said, Wahab, come back. Three times. And Wahab kept going. Then eventually she said, Wahab, go, go. Then he stopped. He looked at her. Why is suddenly telling me go? She said, because I see the children of Hussein. But the girl, the aim is what? She wasn't a Muslim. He wasn't a Muslim. But look, they became and became the first martyrs alongside Abu Abdullah. And so therefore, the companions of Imam Sahib al-Amr also will be like the companions of Abu Abdullah. We just need to work hard. And in conclusion, you know, the mother of Wahab, when they beheaded Wahab, they threw the head of Wahab to her. And she looked at the head. And she said, if Allah give me 20 of these heads, I will be proud to give it back to Hussein. Strong companions. So we need to work on ourselves. We need to. Don't give excuses too much. We all have challenges. I agree with you 100%. But let's try. Self-purification. Purify the heart. Work very hard on yourself. Purify it properly. Try to aim, get into that unshakable iman, a love for Ahlul Bayt, which will then, inshallah, connect us with the love of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. We pray. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala inspire us to be his true slaves and servant. And we pray, Allah grant us opportunities to visit Abu Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. Allah grant us the tawfiqat to extract those practical lessons of Karbala and let those lessons manifest in our lives. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا أعطيناك الكوثر فصل لربك وانحر إن شانئك هو الأبتر اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعجل فرجه بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين إنه خير ناصر ومعين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى أهل بيته الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا عباد الله أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل. Once again, I admonish myself and each and every one of us to arm ourselves with the consciousness in relation to the teachings of Allah. Just one thing I would like to remind myself and my dear mu'minin and mu'minat of, which is no doubt making news around the world, most especially amongst the lovers and the followers of Ahlul Bayt, is this anti Shia rhetoric and aggression. We've just witnessed the killing of the lovers and followers of Ahlul Bayt in New Mexico during this holy month of Muharram. We are told three of them are Shias, and the fourth one, because of having the name of Hussein, he also got massacred. They killed him. But you know, mu'minin and mu'minat, this anti-Shia rhetoric happens almost every year during the holy month of Muharram and Safar. Maybe we are not used to it in the Western world, in this part of the world, and even where I'm coming from. But if you look at Nigeria, for example, even this year, Ashura, on the day of Ashura, some of the lovers and followers of Ahlul Bayt were killed, were murdered, only because they love Ali. Afghanistan, the Hazara community, they are going through a lot. Seriously, they are going through a lot. Losing lives, only because they love Amir al-Mu'mineen. And now it's just next door. Alhamdulillah, we hear some few Sunni scholars that we really appreciate who came out and publicly spoke against it. Our humble request is that we want to see more of our Sunni brothers and sisters, our Sunni shuyukh, coming out and condemning this heinous act, this satanic and barbaric act. For God's sake, we are in a free world and we need to be free to practice. My aim of mentioning this is what? You cannot be a true believer if the matter of another believer does not concern you. You cannot say, no, we are okay. So you're going to fold your arm and do nothing. No, we can make noise in different way to ensure that all are free to practice their faith. And all our great maraja, may Allah lengthen their lives. They always encourage us to unite with our Sunni brothers. And so we don't have that somebody is different from us and we kill him. So we condemn this with the harshest tone it deserves. It doesn't belong to this world. This is completely barbaric. And we hope and pray justice is served. That's our dua. And our solidarity with our Shia brothers and sisters in New Mexico. We may not be physically close to you, but know that we are with you in our prayers and in our heart, inshallah. We pray Allah protect all of us, inshallah. We pray Allah protect Shia Ayan Ali, wherever they may be, inshallah. Of course, we pray Allah protect the entire humanity, inshallah. May we continue to live in peace and harmony. And may we continue to peacefully coexist. Whoever want to cause fitna, want to cause problem, we pray that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala exposes that person, inshallah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. وعلى علينا أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى الصديقة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى سبتي الرحمة وإمامي الهدى الحسن والحسين سيدا شباب أهل الجنة اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى علي بن الحسين زين العابدين صلى على محمد ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والحجة بن الحسن القائم المنتظر صلى على محمد وعلى محمد أجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وسهل الله مخرجه وظهوره اللهم اجعلنا من خير أعوانه وأنصاره ومن المستشهدين بين يديه بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين